Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents To Fight Against This Age, on Fascism and Humanism, by Rob Riemen. Read by Liam Gerrard. Our age reminds one very much of the disintegration of the Greek state. Everything continues, and yet there is no one who believes in it. An invisible bond that gives it validity had vanished, and the whole age is simultaneously comic and tragic. Tragic because it is perishing. Comic because it continues. Søren Kierkegaard, Either Or. Introduction. In 2010, I published in my country, the Netherlands, an essay entitled The Eternal Return of Fascism, at a time when it was already obvious to me that a fascist movement was on the rise again. If this could happen in an affluent welfare state like the Netherlands, I realised the return of fascism in the 21st century could happen anywhere. The small book became an instant bestseller, despite the ferocious and angry criticism of the political and academic class. Their state of denial surprised me, and still worries me, because I do agree with Arnold Toynbee when he, in his magnum opus, A Study of History, argued that civilizations would fall, not because it was inevitable, but because governing elites wouldn't respond adequately to changing circumstances, or because they would focus only on their own interests. Wise men like Confucius and Socrates knew that to be able to understand something, you had to call it by its proper name. The term populism, being the preferred description for a modern-day revolt of the masses, will not provide any meaningful understanding concerning that phenomenon. The late Judith Schlar, a renowned political theorist at Harvard University, was absolutely right when she wrote, at the end of Men and Citizens, her study on Rousseau's social theory, that populism is a very slippery term, even when applied to ideologies and political movements. Does it refer to anything more specific than a confused mixture of hostile attitudes? Is it simply an imprecise way of referring to all those who are neither clearly left nor right? Does the word not just cover all those who have been neglected by a historiography that can allow no ideological possibilities other than conservative, liberal, and socialist, and which oscillates between the pillars of right and left as if these were laws of nature? Is populism anything but a rebellion that has no visa to the capitals of conventional thought? The use of the term populist is only one more way to cultivate the denial that the ghost of fascism is haunting our societies again, and to deny the fact that liberal democracies have turned into their opposite, mass democracies deprived of the spirit of democracy. Why this denial? One reason may be that, from the perspective of science and technology, ghosts and spirits do not exist. Which, of course, is true for Mother Nature. Human nature and human society are, however, a different species. Science and technology will never be able to provide us with a complete understanding of the human being, with his instincts and desires, virtues and values, mind and spirit. Every serious scientist knows this. Alas, not that many in our ruling class do. Their understanding of society is limited by the scientific paradigm of proofs, data, theories, and definitions. The humanities and the arts are therefore ignored and dismissed. Yet, the only knowledge that could provide a true understanding of the human heart, the perennial complexities of societies with their conflicting interests, the causes of modern-day movements and upheavals, and the real requirements of a democratic civilization, is the wisdom of poetry and literature, philosophy and theology, the arts and history. This is the domain of culture. This is where we can find Cleo, the muse of history, always with a book in her hands, offering us the gift of historical awareness. But one has to read books to get to know her and benefit from her gifts. A second reason the return of fascism and the loss of the democratic spirit are hard to accept is the embarrassment of the political left that embraces the tradition of the Enlightenment. The mindset around its articles of faith, human progress, the natural goodness of man, rationality, institutions, and political and social values as the main pillars of a just society will always make it difficult to recognize the impact that the will to power, lust, desire, and self-interest have on the human condition. The point is, we human beings are as irrational as we can be rational, and fascism is the political cultivation of our worst irrational sentiments: resentment, hatred, xenophobia, lust for power, and fear. Facing a fascist Europe, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt knew what he was talking about in March 1933, when he declared in his first inaugural address, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." He was well aware that societies in the grip of fear are responsive to the false promises of the fascist ideology and of autocratic leaders. A sense of crisis, economic insecurity, and the threat of terror or war are the acknowledged causes of a climate of fear. The incompetence to prevent the return of fascism, to fight and eliminate it, is also due to an unacknowledged cause of fear, and the main reason fascism can return so easily in mass democracies: ignorance. This is the third reason the denial of fascism prevails in our times. Acceptance of this fact includes the awareness that, despite all our scientific and technological progress, the worldwide access to information and a provision of higher education for everybody who can afford it, the dominant force in our society is organized stupidity. In my 2008 book, Nobility of Spirit, A Forgotten Ideal, the final chapter, Be Brave, is devoted to the life of an exceptional man, a fighter against his time, Leonie Ginsberg. A Russian Jew born in 1909, Ginsberg as a child emigrated with his family to Italy. He was a brilliant man who translated the wonderful brick of a novel, Tolstoy's Anna Karenina, into Italian when he was just 18. Transmitting and making accessible the best of the European spirit, great literature, would become his strong passion. He translated, taught, founded a publishing house, and set up a magazine, Cultura, culture, to do justice to the original meaning of the word, making room for the collection of the many roads people can travel in their search for the truth about themselves and human existence. Realizing that only culture can help people figure out the truth about their own lives and actions, he made transmitting European culture his life's work. But then Mussolini and his fascists came into power in Italy. Mussolini insisted that all professors sign a declaration of loyalty, or lose their jobs. Of the 1,100 professors, only 10 refused to sign. Leonie Ginsberg was one of those 10. Courage is a rare trait in the academic and intellectual world too. He joined the resistance because he knew that culture and freedom cannot exist without each other. He also knew that fascism, which always crops up in the name of freedom, wants only to destroy freedom. Ginsberg was arrested and deported. When Mussolini was overthrown, Ginsberg returned to Rome to fight against the Nazis, who had taken over. He was arrested again, and then tortured to death by the Nazis at the age of 35. A letter he wrote from prison to his wife Natalia, it would turn out to be his last, ends as follows. Don't worry too much about me. Just imagine that I am a prisoner of war. There are so many, particularly in this war, and the great majority will return home. Let us hope that I'm part of that majority, eh, Natalia? I kiss you again and again and again. Be brave. I will never forget my silent amazement when I read those words for the first time. Be brave. What did he mean by that? I found the meaning of this farewell in Socrates, who taught that courage is the ability to conquer not others, but yourself, the courage to be wise and just, the courage to cultivate your soul. Whoever does not do this is not free, and life without freedom, an empty and accommodating life, is meaningless, and ultimately loveless. Natalia Ginsberg knew this. She carried on her husband's mission in his publishing house and became a great writer of beautiful stories and essays, including a short text in 1960 entitled Les Petites Vertus, The Little Virtues. The first two sentences are as follows. As far as the education of children is concerned, I think they should be taught not the little virtues, but the great ones. Not thrift, but generosity, and an indifference to money. Not caution, but courage, and a contempt for danger. Not shrewdness, but frankness, and a love of truth. Not tact, but a love of one's neighbour and self-denial. Not a desire for success, but a desire to be and to know. The cultivation of the little virtues, small-mindedness, trivia, kitsch, stupidity. What does this have to do with the return of fascism? Unfortunately, everything. Late in life, the director of La Dolce Vita and Amacord, Federico Fellini, a close friend of Natalia Ginsberg, looked back at his own life, which included for a brief period being a member of the Italian fascist youth movement. He came to the following conclusion. Fascism always arises from a provincial spirit, a lack of knowledge of real problems, and people's refusal, through laziness, prejudice, greed, or arrogance, to give their lives deeper meaning. Worse, they boast of their ignorance and pursue success for themselves or their group through bragging, unsubstantiated claims, and a false display of good characteristics, instead of drawing from true ability, experience, or cultural reflection. Fascism cannot be fought if we don't recognise that it is nothing more than the stupid, pathetic, frustrated side of ourselves, of which we should be ashamed. To curb that part of ourselves, we need more than activism for an anti-fascist part, because latent fascism is hidden in all of us. It once gained a voice, authority, and trust, and it can do so again. It is no coincidence that the return of a fascist movement is accompanied by the call to make country X, Y, or Z great again. It is the greatness of force, power, and the false promise of the return to an unattainable past. That greatness is the opposite of the great virtues that Natalia Ginsberg called for, and the human capacity to transcend ourselves, to have imagination and empathy, to live in truth, create beauty, and do justice. This is the true greatness of honouring the dignity of every human being. This is what a democratic civilization is all about. To understand the meaning of big words, we are in need of stories. The return of Europa, her tears, deeds, and dreams, is such a story, about three big, often misunderstood words: democracy, freedom, and civilization. Their meaning matters more than ever as we are confronted with the high art of lying and the twisting of words' meanings, which is part of the nature of fascism. The return of fascism is always possible, but never inevitable. Laws of history do not exist. It is the power of human freedom to go against the current and change the zeitgeist. That is what Friedrich Nietzsche wanted us to know when he wrote, in his untimely meditation, on the uses and disadvantages of history for life, that we should not accept the blind power of the actual, and that instead of conforming to the whole noisy sham culture of our age, we have to be fighters against this age. Leonie Ginsberg fought this fight, and so did Natalia Ginsberg and many others who figure in the following essay and story. It is now upon us to fight against a zeitgeist that destroys the spirit of the democratic civilization. 1. The Eternal Return of Fascism. All I have is a voice to undo the folded lie. W. H. Auden, September 1, 1939. 1. While the Second World War is ravaging the European continent, far away in the North African city of Oran, a doctor finds a dead rat on the landing one spring morning. He tells the concierge, and while he realizes that it is an unusual discovery, he doesn't pay much attention to it. This changes the next day when he finds three dead rats. The concierge swears to him that it must be a boyish prank. There are no rats in this house. However, in the ensuing days, not only does the doctor come across more and more dead rats across the city, but a surprising number of patients in his practice suffer from the same symptoms: swellings, rashes, and delirium, leading to death within 48 hours. He knows that whatever this is, it is an epidemic. Whatever it is? A senior colleague admonishes him. Come on, you know as well as I do what this is. What's more, we know that everyone, the authorities most of all, will deny the truth for as long as possible. This can't be true. We don't have anything like that anymore. We don't live in the Middle Ages. Would you please stop panic-mongering? But denial won't change the facts. And, once the epidemic has the entire city in its grip, the phenomenon has to be named: the bubonic plague. One variant of the phenomenon of denial is the idea that changing words will also change facts. Americans consider the word problem taboo. Any situation that would once have received this label is now called a challenge. Problems don't exist, at least not in the United States of America. The word fascism, insofar as it relates to present-day politics, is likewise taboo in Europe. There is the far right, radical conservatism, populism, right-wing populism, but fascism? No. We don't have that. It can't be true. We don't have anything like that anymore. We live in a democracy. Would you please stop panic-mongering and offending people? In 1947, Albert Camus ended his novel The Plague, an allegory of fascism, with the comment that after the official announcement that the plague's reign of terror has ended, the doctor can't join in the mass celebration. He knew what those jubilant crowds did not know but could have learned from books. The plague bacillus never dies or disappears for good. It can bide its time for decades, slumbering in furniture and linen. It waits patiently in bedrooms, cellars, trunks, handkerchiefs, old papers. Perhaps the day will come when, for the affliction and instruction of humankind, the plague will rouse up its rats again and send them out to die in a happy city. That same year, the German novelist Thomas Mann wrote, "Nietzsche, like a sensitive stylus, signalled the arrival of the fascist era. The era we live in, and which, despite the military victory, we will continue to live in for some time." Camus and Mann certainly weren't the only ones who, once the war was over, quickly realised what we are all too eager to forget, that the fascist bacillus will always remain virulent in the body of mass democracy. Denying this fact, or calling the bacillus something else, will not make us resistant to it. The opposite is true. If we want to put up a good fight, we first have to admit that it has become active again in our social body and call it by its name. Fascism. And fascism is never a challenge, but always a major problem, because it inevitably leads to despotism and to violence. Everything that carries with it these consequences is called a danger. Any policy that tries to deny a problem, or worse, a danger, is called an ostrich policy. It remains true that he who does not learn from history is condemned to repeat it. 2. Mussolini and Hitler, to limit ourselves to this demonic duo, became the most prominent representatives of the politicisation of a mentality that had begun to develop on the European stage long before they appeared. Goethe was one of the first to notice that a fundamental change was taking place in society. In 1812, he wrote to a friend, "If you see how people in general, and young people in particular, don't only give themselves over to their passions and desires, but how, at the same time, the higher and better part of them is distorted and disfigured by the serious follies of the age, so that everything that could lead to their salvation is doomed to fail, then you are not surprised by the heinous deeds which man enacts upon himself and others."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.